Some of you may wonder why I'm taking a time to study on the Messianic movement. Recently, a former Adventist called me. I think he's former, and I'm not totally sure if it's 100% former or only 50% former, okay? He called me and urged me, pleaded with me, that Life Assurance Ministries accept the Messianic movement and move into the full truth of Scripture. And I told him, I said, well, I'm willing to study, and I'm willing to follow the truth of Scripture. But from what I see of it, it is very legalistic. And he said, oh, no, the reason we do these things, it's a prerequisite to having faith in Christ. And the reason I'm teaching on it now is that our combined ministries has helped a few people, and it's quite a few, leave the Adventist church. And we feel a certain obligation to those who leave because often they are, as you can well see, they're grounded in all kinds of things other than the simple gospel. So I think we owe it to them, and I understand this movement is growing rapidly. How rapidly, I don't know at this point. But I think we ought to help them understand that, as I understand it at least, this movement, or part of the movement, really undermines the gospel that was once for all delivered to the saints. I believe that there are two different branches of this movement, and one of them may be fine. Those who use the Hebrew names and the trappings of Old Testament Judaism that are seeking to still proclaim the true gospel, but to win Jews for Jesus. And this can be a very good thing, I think, if it's done right. Secondly, there's a group, and this is the group I'm speaking to, who are trying to minister to Gentiles, and they're using all the Jewish trappings and all the names, the Hebrew names, thinking that they are going to be more pleasing to God. Now, we as New Covenant Christians want to be pleasing to God too, right? And we heard about that this morning, and I'm going to say more about it at the end. So the question comes, how are we going to be pleasing to God? What does the New Testament say about that? So what I want to do first, kind of give you my outline so you know where I'm going. We're going to look briefly, and I say very briefly, at the teachings of the Messianic movement that is targeted toward Gentile Christians. Secondly, I want to evaluate four assumptions upon which this movement is based. And then I would like for us to look at these half a dozen scriptures that talk about how to please God. And at the end, I'm going to ask you a question. I want you to put into one sentence how New Covenant Christians please God. Okay, so that's where we're going. Okay, first of all, the teachings of the Messianic movement. The first one is that you must use the Hebrew names for God and many other of the characters in the Bible. And I found this on their website, and I'm quoting, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Yahshua, for he shall save his people from their sins." Matthew 1:21. Still quoting. Any name other than what Gabriel delivered is man-made. Is your faith from heaven or man-made and inspired from below? In other words, if you use the name Jesus instead of Yahshua, your faith is inspired from below and it's man-made. The second teaching is that salvation is from the Jews. And get your Bibles out. I'm going to look at a couple of texts, one now and then one a little bit later. And from John 4:22, speaking to the woman of Samaria, Jesus said, "You worship something you know not, but we worship whom we know. For salvation is from the Yahudim," or the Jews. They use the well-known text of Matthew 5:17, and that's the one that I want you to look at, Matthew 5:17. This thing has fallen down. I don't know just how to... Here we go. Either my ears are too big or not big enough. I'm not sure which. It sticks out crazy. That's all right. Matthew 5:17. Now, I'm going to read this in the Aramaic English New Testament. I'm going to say more about that later. And this is the Bible that they're using. And this is what Matthew 5:17, and you look at in yours, it's very similar. Do not think that I have come to loosen Torah or the prophets. I have not come to loosen, but to fulfill them through proper meaning. For truly I say to you that until heaven and earth pass away, not one iota or stroke will pass from Torah until everything happens. All who loosen, therefore, from one of these small commandments and teach others thus to the sons of men will be called little in the kingdom of heaven. But all who do and teach this will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Now, accepting this at face value, and this is an Adventist key text as well, as you well know, places one back under the Torah. At least they are honest enough to say that the law there refers to the whole Torah and not just to the Ten Commandments. Now, I want us to look carefully at this verse, and I'm going to explain this verse right now. And I'm going to ask you some questions. Does it say that anything can be removed from Torah until it is all fulfilled or everything happens? How much can be removed? Not one iota. What about the laws for circumcision? Can that be removed? Not if you take this verse at face value. What about the laws for animal sacrifices? Is that part of the Torah? See, one is faced with a dilemma if you really look at this text. Either it is fulfilled or it isn't, and it makes all the difference. If it isn't fulfilled, then we better be right back under the Torah, and we better, all our guys got to be circumcised, and we've got to have the animal sacrifices. If we admit that those are no longer binding, then we're removing those from the Torah, and in so doing, we're admitting that it's been fulfilled. Does that make sense? Okay. The third teaching is, and it springs from this one, is that one must keep all the holy days, including Sabbath, which is Sabbat. So they keep the Sabbath, the moons, the festivals, the Passover, and all those days, Pentecost and so on. The fourth teaching is, and this is interesting, that all the New Testament was first written in Jewish Aramaic. Did you know that? They claim that the original Jewish Aramaic New Testament manuscripts were later translated into Greek, and the translators made many mistakes because they were anti-Semitic. And the recent Aramaic English New Testament, and I should say, I really thank this person who I was talking with because he sent me one free. And I have it at home. I forgot to bring it here. And here's what the advertising copy for this Aramaic New Testament says. It's Aramaic English New Testament. And you go online and look that up, and this is the advertising copy. Listen, I've got quite a bit to quote here, so you understand where they're coming from. Welcome, and thank you for visiting. Yeshua and all the apostles spoke Hebrew and Aramaic and also wrote in their native language. Although the West has developed many religious ideas according to Greek primacy, Greek was the vehicular, not the vernacular, language of Israel. Additionally, the West put much emphasis on the teachings of Greek-based post-apostolic founders of the church. But the fact is, until now, precious few have accessed the original Aramaic and Hebrew teachings, the very words of Yeshua and his apostles. Still quoting. How is the Aramaic English New Testament different? Most New Testaments come from Greek translations that were originally translated from Hebrew and Aramaic texts. However, the Aramaic English New Testament comes directly from the Aramaic. The meaning of the entire verse can be easily altered by a translation. For example, the Greek Kyrios often is translated Lord. However, there is both Lord the Father and Lord the Son, which the translator must choose. However, the Father, YHWH, and the Son are clearly distinguished in Aramaic. There is no confusion about the speaker or who is being addressed. So that's the Bible that they're using, which is the original ones that the apostles wrote and spoke, okay? A third thing, and I won't spend much time on this, the Messianic movement strongly opposes anything that can be remotely tied to paganism. Christmas is anathema. The Christmas tree, holly, Easter, Sunday worship, all have pagan origins. Worship on Sunday is pagan, sun worship, and it's also the mark of the beast. One of the websites had this summary comparison. Messianic faith, mainstream Christianity. Messianic faith honors Sabbath worship. Mainstream uses Sunday morning for the time of worship. Messianic celebrates the biblical holidays of Leviticus 23. Mainstream Christians celebrate holidays of pagan origin. Messianic practices biblical dietary laws. Mainstream Christianity ignores biblical dietary laws. Messianic practices the least of these commandments. Mainstream Christianity says these are just for the Jews. All right, now let's evaluate these. I want to look at four assumptions. And space and time don't permit us to do a thorough evaluation. I would like, in fact, I'm planning to do additional research, and with Colleen's permission, maybe I can have an article in Proclamation on this, because I think it's necessary that if Adventists are falling into this, we need to be able to understand it and see where the error is, if there is error. All right, now, the first thing about holy names. One must remember that while the old covenant was between the nation of, between God and who? The nation of Israel only. All right? The new covenant is between God and Jesus Christ. And all nations are the recipients of the new covenant blessings. And this fact is underlined at the birth of the church, when the Holy Spirit was poured out and the apostles were given the gift of tongues. Real languages, and we have this testimony. Why are not all these who are speaking Galileans, and how is it that we each hear them in our own language to which we were born? Then there is listed about a dozen different language and culture groups. And the reference concludes with this brief but insightful statement. We hear them in our own tongues speaking the mighty deeds of God. Now, Scripture uses a plethora of titles for God and names. Firstborn from the dead, highest of earthly kings, Alpha and Omega, God, the Lord God, Almighty, Son of Man, first and last, the living one, Son of God, faithful witness, Creator, Lion of the tribe of Judah, Root of David, the Lamb, the Shepherd, the Christ, the faithful and true, the Word of God, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Rose of Sharon, and then we could go on for another 15 or 20 minutes. And then also add to this fact, and it is a fact that has been brought out already this weekend. The exact pronunciation of the sacred name is unknown. There was a time when the Jews said the sacred name was too holy to speak. So they added, whenever they came to it in the Hebrew writings, they would add another name. They would call it by another name out loud. And the older Hebrew did not have vowel points. It only had consonants. And over time, they lost the pronunciation for the name of God. And to insist that one speak the original name is an exercise in futility. There are a number of supposedly, what is the correct pronunciation? Get it right here yet. Here are some four of them that are argued for. Yahweh, probably the most popular. Yehovah, Yahweh, and Yahweh. Which one is it? See, if you're going to say you've got to pronounce the name a certain way, then you better know which name it is. So that's kind of an exercise in futility. All right, salvation is from the Jews, meaning one must keep the whole Torah. I don't need to go into this because this is the whole idea of the new covenant. And you see it in my notes, you see it in Gary's notes here, you know, as he's been preaching. We're under a new covenant. We're not under the old covenant anymore. That's number two. Number three, looking at the underpinnings of this movement, it says that Jesus and the apostles wrote and spoke in Jewish Aramaic. And I found some very interesting things in answer to this. Recent archaeological evidence has shown that the Jews at the time of Jesus spoke Greek as well as Jewish Aramaic. They were bilingual, and there is much evidence, I'm only going to read a little bit, to support this. They have found ossuaries of the actual tomb of Caiaphas, the high priest who condemned Christ, or at least his family. And these and other Jewish ossuaries of the time are inscribed in Greek. Greek was in widespread use in the Roman Empire in New Testament times. Even the Romans spoke Greek, as the interpretation or inscriptions in Rome and elsewhere attest. And what about the Gospels? All four Gospels depict Jesus conversing with Pilate without an interpreter. Pilate didn't speak the Hebrew. He only spoke the Greek. So there's good evidence that Jesus spoke Greek. There is no mention of an interpreter. All right? And there's a lot more evidence. I wish I could have time to do it all. In Mark 7, we have the record of Jesus conversing with the Syrophoenician. Remember, the Syrophoenician woman brought her little child and was having problems. And the conversation was obviously in Greek, because a Syrophoenician woman wouldn't be speaking Hebrew. Matthew 4:15 quotes an Old Testament reference to Jesus fulfilling a mission to, and I quote, the Galilee of the Gentiles, which was a Greek-speaking area. Jesus used the word hypocrite. Does anybody know what that word is? Hypocrite. He used it some 16 times, and hypocrite, is not in the Aramaic language. Okay? Joseph, Jesus' earthly father, or I should say supposed father, was a tecto. It's sometimes translated carpenter. I don't know if you've seen some of the new videos and things on it. They think it probably was more like a stonemason. And some believe that Joseph's father was involved in some of the stonework, at that time for the Romans, who would, in his trade, needed to speak Greek. So you can just feature Jesus speaking Greek. Matthew was a what kind of a person? Tax collector. And he would set up his tax booth where everybody was coming by so he could get more money, and he doubtless spoke Greek. Acts 6:1 says, "Now in those days when the disciples were growing in number, a complaint arose on the part of the Greek-speaking Jews against the native Hebrews, because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food." So there's evidence, lots of it, and I've only scratched the surface, that the apostles and Jesus were bilingual and could speak both Jewish Aramaic and Greek. Now, the fourth assumption is that the first New Testament manuscripts were written in Aramaic, Jewish Aramaic, and that is simply not true. All All the earliest New Testament manuscripts we have are in Greek. Until recently, a portion of John's writings, this is when I took classes in lower criticism in the formation of the canon, a portion of John's writings were considered to be the oldest fragment known. However, recently there appears to be that one of Matthew is even earlier. The London Times reported the evidence, and I'll just pick and choose a few things that, for the time's sake. Important breakthrough in biblical scholarship on the level of, with the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Some scholars have questioned the accuracy of the New Testament as historical, believing that the earliest texts were written long after the events described. However, a careful analysis by Professor Thede has dated the fragments, and these are the ones in Matthew, to the middle of the first century, thereby indicating that there is evidence that the Matthew Gospel was written only a generation after the crucifixion or earlier. And it goes on to say, parts of the New Testament may have been written by actual eyewitnesses who knew Christ rather than authors in the second century writing down an oral tradition. Now that's what we believe, isn't it? That these people were, the Gospels we have were written by the actual authors, and it's becoming more and more evident. Now Dr. Thede goes on, The Magdalene fragment now appears to belong to a style of handwriting that was current in the first century A.D. that slowly petered out around the middle first century. Even a hesitant approach to questions of dating would therefore seem to justify the date as early first century, about 100 years earlier than thought. The lines on the fragment are from Matthew 26 and include the oldest reference to the Mary Magdalene and the betrayal of Christ by Judas. The fragment was written soon after the death of Christ. Notice what he says now. It's written in Greek. Putting in the trash compactor, once and for all, the notions that the apostles did not write in Greek. So, my conclusion is that the assumptions upon which this new messianic movement are based, at least the ones that I'm referring to, not necessarily the ones that are working with the actual Jews, are faulty, and it really does undermine the new covenant, and it leads us away from the gospel and puts us back under the law. Now, take your Bibles. And I want us to look at New Testament texts that talk about how to please God. They want to please God by keeping all the feast days, by using all the Hebrew names and doing all those kind of things. We want to please God as New Covenant Christians, right? Turn to Romans 8, 8 and 9. I'm going to read it here so I don't have to turn to it. And I have it in my notes. Romans 8, 8 and 9. I think this is a fundamental idea or fundamental concept. Those who are in the flesh, read me the next three words, cannot please God. However, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him. Now, I used to do evangelism totally different than I do now. We were taught that if a person was going to be baptized and come into the church, you had to start cleaning them up before Christ could accept them. They had to lay off the smoking and the drinking and the rest of the stuff, okay? You guys know what it is. But here it says, unless you're born again, you can't please God. So there is no use, as far as leading a person to Christ, to have them clean up the outside first. Sure, it's good, always good, to have, you know, to have people not continue in self-destructive behavior. But that's not preparing them for Jesus Christ, for the gospel. We have to come as we are, dead in sin, helpless. There's no cleaning up. We just come to God filthy. This man receives sinners. So the first thing you have to do to please God is what? You've got to be born again. Okay? You've got to be in the Spirit. Okay. Go to Hebrews 11:6. You know this by heart, don't you? Hebrews 11:6. You know it by heart. And without faith, it is impossible to please Him. The one who comes to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of those who seek Him. In other words, we're so blessed to believe in a good God, one that really exists. Every day, Carolyn and I remind each other how blessed we are for the journey we've had together, off and on since the third and fourth grade and in high school, and then for the last 56 years of marriage. And we're so blessed to be part of Life Assurance Ministries. And we're so blessed to have friends that we worked with for 7 years here, you know, with us today. We're so blessed. God has been so good. He is a rewarder of those who seek Him. And we have been rewarded, you know, our cup has been filled up and it's overflowing. God rewards those who seek Him. How? By faith. 1 Thessalonians 2, turn there. 1 Thessalonians 2, 3 and 4. Here's a text, and it's also a promise and a challenge. I want to talk a little bit about it. 1 Thessalonians 2, 3 and 4. For our exhortation does not come from error or impurity or by way of deceit, just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. So we speak not as pleasing men, but, and we could insert pleasing there, pleasing God who examines our hearts. When we proclaim the gospel, we have to do it without trying to please men. And this is a real temptation for pastors. If you're a pastor and you have somebody on your board who's a big donor in supporting the church, you know, it's really easy to compromise. And it's really easy for many of us to compromise when we're proclaiming the truth. And I'm sure that I have compromised at times, but there are times that I haven't compromised. And God has blessed those times way beyond anything I could ever imagine. So this is the way we please God. We preach the gospel without pleasing men, knowing that God is the one who examines our hearts. We don't have to worry if we get letters to the Church of Satan addressed to our house. We don't have to worry if people condemn us to death. We don't have to worry if people write letters to Proclamation and you know, you've read the letters. Because God is the one who examines our hearts. And if we're proclaiming the gospel clearly, we are pleasing to Him. All right, one more. Hebrews, or a couple more, I guess. Hebrews 13, 20 and 21. This is a fantastic promise. Hebrews 13, 20 and 21. And this fits in so nicely to what Pastor Gary has been saying and also what Tim said. Now the God of peace, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord. Notice this. Equip you for every good thing to do His will, working in us that which is pleasing in His sight. Now you tell me, what do we do to please God here? That's the wrong question, isn't it? Okay, what is that? What does it say here? May God. God is the one who is working in us by His Spirit that which is pleasing in His sight. So isn't that cool? God does in us the things that are pleasing to Him. That's pretty good. And as I said in my breakout, and that's what Pastor Gary said, you know, about 2 Corinthians 3:18. How are we transformed? By gazing into the glory of the gospel. And if you look at the notes, not now, but in my outline in the back of the book, all the things that we are in Christ Jesus. In Colossians, we're told that we are to recognize that we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. And we are to focus on things in heaven and not on things of earth. And when we know who we are in Jesus Christ, that we're forgiven, that we're qualified for the saints in light, we're, you know, we have eternal life. When we have all these dozens of things that we are in Christ Jesus, we are free from sin, we're free from the law. You know, when we know all those things and we focus on them, then what happens? The Holy Spirit transforms us, and the fruits of the Spirit run out of our life. And God working in us pleases Him. Now, in one sentence, someone, how do New Covenant Christians please God? I'll say one thing, it's not by keeping all the laws of Torah. How do we do it? Gaze in His glory. Anybody want to put it in different words? Trust Him. Place Him in our hearts, or allow Him to be placed in our hearts. Faithfully sharing the message. Okay, I kind of, you know, all these are right. I would say it's accepting of His grace and then graciously going out to other sinners and telling them about the good grace of God that will make them pleasing if they'll only respond in love. Father in heaven, we thank You that You have made us pleasing to the Father simply by Your grace, what You've done for us, what You're doing in us. Oh God, I just pray that the gospel might really come alive in our lives, that we would focus on who we are in Christ Jesus and what He has done and what He is doing. And by so doing, Lord, we want to let the Holy Spirit have His place in our life, that we might have many, many fruits that would go out and spread the good news to others. In Jesus' name.